Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone out to First Baptist on this beautiful sunny day. So we're just going to go ahead and get into these announcements. Not very much going on here, but summer's out, and that's not very good for husbands that have wives to teach, because that means they're going to be at home. And but it's all right. It's good. There's a woman's retreat, and there's a sign-up sheet outside there. Any other announcements we need to make? June 26th, whitewater rafting for youth 12 and older. It'll be here before you know it. Any other announcements? Any birthdays this past week? Alrighty. We got one coming. Got the prayer request in the bulletin. Is there anything we need to add to that? Let's remember this. Any others? Let's remember this. Any others? Just remember this. Any others? If not, Brother Ray Hedrick, would you lead us this morning?
Or watch the video last week. This is just in this area. It's 33 counties. It's centered in Knox County. They're in affiliation with other organizations against human trafficking, but as far as this is an independent in this area. And if you look around, you may see some of these in your seat to give you more information about human trafficking. But this is the Community Coalition Against Human Trafficking. It's a 501 nonprofit, and like I said, it does take in Union County, 33 counties in this area. And human trafficking, if you will look and read, it tells you that it's where they take people against their will to work or for sexual reasons, and it's to make money. It's a $1 billion industry. So it goes right on here in Union County as well as in the East Tennessee area with 640, 40, 75, all those intersections. That's a key place for human trafficking to be prevalent. So this morning as we give this offering, it's going to help people in this area. But the place is in Knoxville. They do ask for volunteers. They ask for donations. There's different things. It's also on this sheet. You can go online to community, the CCAH, I won't call it catch all the time, but CCHT, and you can look and see what kind of needs they have. It might be something you're interested in and volunteering for. So we're going to watch a video, and then we have an offering box that we'll take up right after the video.
Human trafficking, commercial sexual exploitation, and forced labor seem a world away. But according to the International Labor Organization, there are more slaves at this moment than at any other time in history. UNICEF tells us that of the estimated 40.3 million people subjected to modern slavery and psychological bondage, approximately 70% of those are women and girls, some as young as 6 years old, with abusers who can range from family members and acquaintances to gangs and persons unknown. How is it possible that something so insidious has become widespread? A recent report by the University of Texas at Austin states that in Texas alone, there were almost 80,000 sexually trafficked youths. What methods could possibly allow victims from all walks of life to be exploited and abused in this way, from the most vulnerable and at risk to those from privilege? The process can be one of violence, including kidnapping, or desperation where sex is traded for food, shelter, or necessities for existence. But often, it's a case of careful grooming, identifying a victim by looking for vulnerabilities. Traffickers target victims with emotional neediness, low self-esteem, and those under stress. By gathering information in an interested way, the goal is to create trust and build dependency, while isolating the abused from family and friends. Through phone calls and social media, the trafficker begins slowly, often supplying phones and other devices so that communication can be continuous and undercover. By fulfilling a need, the trafficker strives to become everything to their victim, including becoming the only person they can trust. Often, the dependency building includes gifts, drugs, or alcohol. But sometimes it's simply the fulfilling of a desperate need to be seen. Once trust is established and dependency is complete, control begins. Often there's been nothing asked of the victim until this point, when suddenly the threat of violence and sexual demands leave the victim confused, fearful, and psychologically battered. Sexual exploitation and physical abuse create chronic overstimulation of the brain, as the threat of violence leads the abused to stay on high alert. The true horror is that even rescued survivors have years of recovery ahead, since recovery requires overriding trauma-related neural pathways that years of victimization create. Sadly, any association with the sex industry creates an unforgiving stigma that both shames and blames the victim. Too often, survivors are treated as criminals, as we overlook the process that has created these circumstances and the devastating consequences that can last a lifetime. This must stop. It will take deep understanding and multiple healing strategies in order to help survivors develop needed skills such as self-confidence, problem-solving, and self-regulation. Only in this way can survivors distance themselves from their traffickers, reestablish their identity, and come to believe that they have inherent value.
Red Church Hymnal 333.
Oh,
want to invite you to stand and join along with us as we sing Holy Water.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to be back in God's house this morning, and I do appreciate all the singing that we've been able to rejoice in this morning, and thankful for all the songs that have been sung. If you have your Bibles this morning, we're going to be reading from the book of Acts, and we're going to start with chapter 6, and we're going to start with verse number 8. And we've, of course, been going through the book of Acts, and for this morning, the thought that the Lord has given me as a message this morning is that your life can make an impact for Christ. Your life can make an impact for Christ. And we're going to look this morning at for one man in particular, that his life was an impact. And you never know, I want to say this morning, you never know who you may impact in your life. You never know the way you live your life each and every day, the Christian, the light, the witness, the testimony, the example that you may be by just the life you live, you never know who or how that it may impact somebody's life. And I think this scripture this morning we're going to look at is a very good example. And in a way, it could be a very surprising person, if you see, as we're going to look this morning, of whose life Stephen this morning may have impacted. So we're going to read starting with chapter 6 and verse number 8. And the Bible says this, "And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of Libertines, and the Cyrenians and the Alexandrians, and of them of Sicily and of Asia, disputing with Stephen. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. And they suborned men, which said, We have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes, and came upon him, and caught him, and brought him to the council, and set up false witness, which said, This man ceaseth not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place, and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us. And all that sat in the council looked steadfastly on him, saw his face as it had been the face of an angel." And that's all we'd like to read for right now. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for today. God, we are so thankful that, God, you lead us. Lord, you guide us. And, Father, you direct us. And, Lord, we pray this morning that, God, you would help each and every one of us sitting here this morning. Father, and for those that are watching and listening and viewing online, we pray that, God, you would work in all of our hearts and in all of our lives. God, show us this morning and remind us, Father, of the life that we live each and every day. Father, of how important that it is. And that, Father, the life that we live every day, that, God, if we live for you, that, Lord, you can use our lives to be an impact for you, Lord, for others. And that, Father, someone that is close or near us may come to the saving knowledge and the understanding of you. Lord, we love you, we thank you, we praise you, and all this we ask in your name. Amen. Amen. We find here that Stephen... Stephen was a man, starting off first we know about Stephen, was in chapter 6, the first couple of verses, we find that Stephen was one of the seven that were chosen to serve the tables of the widows. The Bible teaches us about Stephen. It says this in verse 5 of chapter 6, says, Stephen, they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. A little bit about Stephen is we know that Stephen was a man that was full of faith. The Bible teaches us there in verse number 8, as we first read, said he was full of faith and power and great wonders. He did great wonders and miracles among the people. God used Stephen, and he used his life mightily for God's glory and his honor and his kingdom. Stephen lived a life, I believe, full of faith, full of surrender to Jesus Christ. We know that he was one of the seven that was chosen. The Bible teaches us that. But Stephen was also a messenger of the gospel. Amen. Stephen was one that was willing to share the message of Jesus Christ. Church, you and I that have been saved by the grace of God, we ought to be willing and willing messengers. Amen. We ought to be willing to send and share and to tell the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Stephen was a messenger of the gospel. Not only that, he was a powerful speaker. He was. And you read chapter 7, and we're not going to read all of chapter 7 this morning, but we're going to hit some highlights of chapter 7 and the high points that's in this chapter. But when you go, when you take some time this week, read over chapter 7 of the book of Acts, you're going to see how powerful of a speaker that Stephen was. And my friend, this was not Stephen in his own self or in his own mind or in who he was, but my friend, this was the power of the Holy Spirit of God speaking through Stephen. Stephen was a willing mouthpiece and a willing vessel. And my friend, he was one that was surrendered to the cause of Christ and was willing, and my friend, was able and allowing the holy power, the Holy Spirit of God, to speak, my friend, and work through him and his life. You see, that is the way Stephen was. He gave us a great example. Church, we ought to be willing vessels. Amen? We ought to be willing vessels. And we ought to be willing to the point to say, we allow the Lord. Say, Lord, just use me as a vessel for you. Lord, speak through me. Work through me. Use me, Father. That Lord, my life could be a witness. That my life and the way I live could be a testimony. It could impact others, Lord, for your glory, your honor, and your kingdom. You see, the life that Stephen lived, my friend, he was an impact for Christ. His life impacted others for the cause of Christ. Now, another thing about Stephen was, we're going to find as you read in chapter 7, Stephen was a martyr for Jesus Christ. Stephen, my friend, was the first one that the Scripture records that he willingly laid down his life for the faith and the cause of Jesus Christ. And I thought about that as I studied on this week, and I come across this, I want to share this with you. Before a person can give his life for the gospel, he must first live his life for the gospel. Amen? My friend, before he gave his life for the gospel, Stephen was living his life daily for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And my friend, that's the way you and I should be. We ought to live our lives daily for the cause of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Stephen's life, I looked at this when you study about Stephen, and when you read how Stephen in the Scripture in chapter 7 and even in chapter 6, some is what we read this morning. Stephen's life and the way he lived his life, my friend, it ought to be a challenge for you and I. It ought to challenge us as Christians, my friend, that we ought to have such a desire, that we ought to have such a love, we ought to have such a drive, that, my friend, we ought to be willing, my friend, to allow God to work and live in us in such a way that our lives impact others for the gospel of Jesus. Amen? Stephen's life impacted others. Not only that, but his death was a lasting impact as well. And this morning, we're going to look at a couple of things, and one man in particular of whose, when Stephen, my friend, was stoned to death and he gave his life for the cause of Jesus Christ, the death of Stephen, his death impacted a man by the name of Saul of Tarsus in a mighty way. And we know him as Paul of Tarsus. Amen? I want to look at chapter 7 here at verse number, a couple of verses here we're going to look at, just kind of hit the high points. But when you begin to study on chapter 7, you're going to find here that Stephen, as we read in chapter 6, that Stephen was, he was arrested. He was brought before the Sanhedrin council. Now, the verse number, chapter 7, verse number 1 says this, "Then said the high priest, Are these things so? And he said, Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia." I want to stop right there for a minute. This was the same high priest
priest that my friend, that he, that Jesus Christ appeared before. Do you know that? This was Caiaphas. This was the same high priest that our Lord and Savior stood before when the band of men came and they took him and they brought him before the high priest. My friend, not only was this the same high priest that our Lord Jesus stood before, but this was the same high priest that we read about in earlier chapters of 4 and 5 that Peter and my friend John stood before, that when they healed the man that sat by the gate called Beautiful. My friend, these were the same council that told Peter and John, they said, not to speak of Jesus or perform miracles in His name anymore. But yet, my friend, they were determined in their heart. They had it settled in their heart that they were not going to be quiet, that they were going to continue to preach, they were going to continue to teach and share, and they were going to continue to work the miracles in the name of Jesus Christ, that others could come to know Him as their Savior and as their Lord. You see, this was the same council, the Sanhedrin. This was the same group of religious leaders, my friend, that our Lord stood before, and Peter and John. And now they had brought Stephen. They had brought Stephen before Him. And that Stephen began to address the Sanhedrin. And my friend, they brought Stephen and they began to falsely accuse him. Because the Bible says this in chapter 6 there in the last part, it said, "For we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us." You see, the Sanhedrin, they were made up of the Sadducees, and they accused him of wanting to do away with the customs of Moses. Now, that was very important, you see, because to be able to understand this, the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin, the council, my friend, they were the ones that studied, and my friend, they were all about the writings and the customs and the ways of Moses. That was what they were about. They were about the law. They were about the Old Testament way, and that was what they were all about. So they heard Stephen talking, and they said, man, he's talking about what Jesus said, that Jesus said that he would build this, destroy this temple, build it in 3 days. He talked about how the holy place and the law, he talked about that, how Jesus came. He said, listen, I came not to do away with the law or to destroy the law. He said, but I came to fulfill the law. Amen. And Jesus did exactly that when he died on the cross of Calvary, when they buried him, and on the third day he rose from the dead, and 40 days later he ascended back to God the Father, and he's sitting there this morning at the right hand of God making intercession for you and for me. Amen. Jesus fulfilled the law and prophets. Amen. So what we find here is Stephen began to preach. Stephen began to preach, and Stephen started all the way at the very beginning. He brought up Abraham. And what Stephen began to do is, most of chapter 7, is you're going to find that Stephen preached on the history, God's history of Israel, His chosen people. And he went all the way back, all the way to Abraham. And he brought it all the way from Abraham up to Jacob. And then from Jacob to Joseph when they were in Egypt. And not only from Joseph, but then he went to Moses. And then from Moses, how Moses and God had delivered the people out of bondage. And he brought them through the wilderness. And my friend, he took it all the way down the line, all the way to Jesus Christ. And these are some of the things he shared to me. You see, Stephen, he made 3 points to him about the history there of Israel. Number one was Israel's history. The history that we find in the book of Genesis of what God did, and even in the book of Exodus, we find that history is the history of Israel's history is God's history in the world. Amen? And the events that took place is what God did with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. You think about it for just a minute. You think about Abraham. My friend, when he was down there and God told him, he said, listen, Abraham, he said, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. And my friend, he said this, and he told Sarah, he said, Sarah, he said, in your old age, he said, you're going to bring forth a son, and he said, this son will be the seed of the promise. My friend, you think about the miraculous, the wonderful acts of God, how God with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, he reached down and he touched the very barren womb of my friend, and she brought forth the son, and they named him Isaac. And we know that, my friend, that Isaac was the promise. He was the seed. But God came to Abraham one day and he said, Abraham, I want you to take your only son Isaac up on the mountain. And he knows that when he took him up, and we know that Abraham was willing to sacrifice, my friend, to give up his own son. But Hebrews said that Abraham had enough faith and belief in God that he knew if he was able, my friend, that if he killed him that day and he offered him as a sacrifice, he knew God was able to raise him from the dead. That's faith this morning in God. Amen. He was able. You think about the mighty hand of God, how he brought down Jacob, and how the brothers, they were without food and in the land of Canaan, and there was a drought. But yet, my friend, the evilness that was done toward Joseph, and how Joseph was sold into a band of men, and he found himself down at the house of Potiphar as a slave. And we know that Joseph was wrongfully accused of Potiphar's wife, and he was thrown in prison. And we know that, my friend, Joseph spent time there in prison. But there came a day that God brought forth his release, and he brought him before the Pharaoh. And my friend, God used Joseph in a mighty way to interpret the dream of Pharaoh. And he told him there'd be 7 good years of plenty, and how there'd be 7 bad years of famine. And we know that, my friend, through that, God prepared a way, and he made a way for his people, because there was no bread, there was no corn that was found in all the land of that time except for Egypt, because God had made a way. And he blessed the Egyptians, my friend, with 7 good years of plenty, and they put it in the storehouses. And my friend, everybody came to Egypt, and Joseph, my friend, opened the storehouses, and everyone could eat, even his own father and brothers. God moved in a mighty way. And we find here that not only did he make a point of to share the history of Israel, but he shared about God's mighty hand in the workings of Israel's history. Another point that he made there was, he told him, he said, listen, people's been worshiping God way before this temple was ever built, is what he told them. He said, people have worshiped God way before the temple. Why did he say that? Because these people loved the temple. Man, they were obsessed with this place of worship. And what did Stephen remind him? He said, listen, the God we serve is greater than this temple. Amen? The God we serve is greater than this temple. You think about what Solomon said. Solomon said, how can I build a house for God, seeing that the heavens of the heavens cannot contain him? Amen? What was it that God told him? As Solomon wrote, he said that heaven, he said that heaven was his throne and earth was his footstool. You see, my friend, God, he cannot be contained in a house or in a place or in a temple. But yet, my friend, Stephen told me, he said, listen, the God that we serve, the God, my friend, of our fathers, he's great, he's mighty. My friend, he's bigger than any temple that you could worship or serve. I'm glad of that this morning. Amen. I'm glad that the God of the universe, he is so great, he's so big, he's so mighty, but yet, my friend, he could still live in the heart of you and I this morning that's been saved by the grace of God. I'm glad his home, he set up his abode inside the heart of you and I that have been saved today. Amen. Not only that, but Stephen went on to tell me, he said, listen, he shared with him, he told him, listen, despite the failures. You see, he told them about how Israel's history was. He said, listen, you guys have rejected God. You've rebelled against God. You took his own son and brought him up, and you delivered him to the high priest, the council. You sent him to the cross of Calvary to be killed, to be hung upon the tree. And, but you know what? I'm glad to know this morning. And he told me, he said, listen, despite your failures, despite your choices, despite the things that you have done, God still has a working plan. Amen? I'm glad to know this morning that God still has a plan.
God still has a plan. You think about the life of Moses. You think about the life of Joseph. Joseph's life could have not been any worse, it seems like. I mean, could you imagine? He went down. He was sold of his own brothers to a band of men. He was carried away and become a slave at Potiphar's house. And then he was wrongfully accused and thrown into prison. And he had to spend years in prison. Do you not think that Joseph at some point, in one point in time, said, Lord, what is it? What have I done to deserve to be exiled from my family? What have I done that my brothers hate me so much that they got rid of me? Lord, what have I done that I was falsely accused at Potiphar's house and now I'm spending my time here in this prison and I'm rotting away and there's nothing? Lord, are you still there? God, do you still hear me? God, what's going on? Think about Moses, my friend, how Moses' life, you see, his mother and his father, they couldn't keep him. They kept him as long as they could. Then they made a little ark for him, and my friend, they floated him down the Nile River. It was the very hand of God that protected and watched over Moses as he floated down the Nile. My friend, listen, the survival rate down the Nile River was not very good, but my friend, the hand of God protected Moses while he floated down. And my friend, while he was there, Pharaoh's daughter found him there in the bulrush, and my friend, she took him, she raised him in Pharaoh's house, and he knew the ways and the things of Pharaoh there in the Egyptians. But there come a time where my friend Moses went and he spent 40 years on the backside of the desert taking care of a bunch of sheep, and then God came to him and he spoke to him, and then God used him to lead the people out of bondage. And my friend, he brought them out of Egypt, and he brought them in, my friend, through the wilderness. But there came a time that, you see, Moses, because of his disobedience, he didn't get to enter in to the land of Canaan. But you see, God has a plan. And that's what Stephen was showing here. Listen, one thing we've got to remember is when things aren't looking good, when circumstances or situations change in our life, and we got to think, Lord, where you at? Or why is this going on? Or why is this happening? Number one, we've got to remember that God's in control. We've got to remember that there is nothing that surprises our God. He is not caught off guard, but He has everything under control. Number two, we've got to remember that this world is not all that there is. Amen? This world is not it. For you and I that have been saved by the grace of God, Jesus tells us this in His Word. He said, "For heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall never pass away." This whole place is going to go away one of these days. But for you and I that have been saved by the grace of God, we're going to a place, my friend, that we're going to live throughout all eternity. We got an everlasting, we've got an eternal home with God the Father. Why? Because God is eternal. And this whole place is just temporary. And we're just passing through. Amen? We are a pilgrim and a stranger. But my friend, we're looking for a bigger home. We're looking for a greater home. We're looking for a greater place one of these days, my friend, for the people and for the children of God. I'm glad to know that, my friend, my hope, my faith, my trust is not in this old world. Amen? But my hope, my faith, and my trust is in heaven. It's in the Lord. Amen? It's in Jesus and the death on the cross. It's in the burial and it's in the resurrection. And it's in the hope and the faith and the trust that I have in God, knowing that one of these days He's coming back for you and I that have been saved by His grace. Amen? That's hope this morning. You see, God is just. Amen? He's going to make all things right. But not only that, sometimes you think about Moses, you think about Joseph, and you look at Stephen. Sometimes we go through these things and we face these things because God wants to use you and He wants to use me. And as He used Moses and as He used Joseph and as He used Stephen to make a difference and to make an impact on someone's life in this world. God has a plan. Amen? He wants to use you and He wants to use me. Turn over, if you would, this morning. We're going to read chapter 7, verse 54.
We're going to look here at Stephen. After Stephen finished up his message, this is where he got to in verse 54. And he said, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witness laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and he cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Stephen stood for the Lord Jesus. And not only that, we find here that when Stephen stood and when Stephen preached, what happened? Stephen, the Bible said, was full of the Holy Ghost. He was full of the Spirit of God. And when he stood for the Lord, here's what happened. It said that Stephen looked steadfastly into heaven and he saw the glory of God. Man, could you imagine? We can't imagine, can we? To be able to see the glory of God. See, Stephen saw the glory of God, my friend. He was able to look into heaven. You think about Moses. When Moses was upon the mountain, what did he ask the Lord? He said, God, he said, I want to see your glory. God told him, he said, Moses, he said, there's not a man that can see my glory and yet live. And he said, but here's what I'm going to tell you. Here's what I'm going to do. He said, there's a little place over here in the cleft of the rock. And he said, when I pass by, he said, when my glory passed by, he said, I'm going to shove you right in the cleft of that rock. And he said, all you're going to see is just the hinder part, just the backside of me and my glory as I pass by. My friend, we know that God did that. And my friend, all Moses was able to see was just the backside, the hind part of God as he passed by. And we know from that Moses, my friend, his face shone for days as he come down off the mountain. His face glowed. Why? Because he got to see just a little glimpse of the glory of God. And he got to be in the presence of Almighty God. Listen, my friend, Stephen got to see it. He got to see the glory of God. Not only that, but he saw Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Stephen stood for God. Jesus stood for him. Amen? Jesus stood for Stephen when he stood for him. I believe he said this. And he said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. What'd they do? They all came at him. They began to stone Stephen. But my friend, there was one man that was standing there that day. And he was standing there and he got to behold what had took place. And the death of Stephen and his life and his message and the testimony, I believe, impacted this man in a mighty way. His name was Saul of Tarsus, which was later converted on the road to Damascus, and his name was changed to Paul. My friend, this man, Saul, was a Hebrew of Hebrews. He was one, my friend, that was well learned in the law of God. And he was one that he was going out, he was persecuting Christians and those that believed in Jesus. He was throwing them in prison. He was having them put to death. Why? Because he felt like what he was doing was right according to the law of God. But I believe the death of Stephen that day did something. It impacted this man mightily. You know, Stephen's death, it wasn't in vain. Stephen's death had such an impact. I want to read a couple of things that it did. Number one, we're going to read, you'll find that Philip, he went on and he began to evangelize and he began to share the gospel. Not only did Philip go through and he began to evangelize and share and preach and tell the gospel, we know that Saul was saved and converted. His life was changed. Not only that, we'll find that Peter went on a missionary as well, and he began to preach, and he began to teach Jesus Christ, and there were people that were saved, people were converted, churches were started. We know that the church there in Antioch, it was started, it was founded. Why? It all come from the preaching of Stephen and how he stood for the Lord. His life impacted others in a mighty way for the cause of Christ. Church, the message this morning is your life. God can use you. He can use me. He can use this church to be a mighty impact in this community and on the lives of others for His glory, His honor, His kingdom. It only takes you and I being willing. We've got to be willing. And we've got to say, Lord, Stephen surrendered it all, didn't he? Think about that old hymn we sing from time to time again, an invitation. I surrender it all. All to Jesus, I surrender. You think about that this morning, church. If we would live a life surrendered to the Lord each and every day, man, I tell you what, it'd be mighty. It'd be great on how God could use us for His glory, His honor, His kingdom. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's not about us, but it's all about Him today. And it's all about His glory, His honor, His kingdom, and seeing lost people saved and come to know Christ as their Savior and as their Lord. Your life can make an impact for Christ. Amen? It can. God can use us mightily if we allow Him and we let Him. I've said this time and time again. I'll say it again. John the Baptist said it best. He said, I must decrease, but He must increase. Man, we need that in our lives daily. We need to decrease. I tell you what, old Corey's got to get out of the way every day. If Corey leads, man, I'm going to mess it up. I need the Lord every day leading, guiding, directing, helping me, increasing in my life daily to be able to be a witness, to be able to be an impact, to be able to be a help in somebody's life each and every day. Amen? We need the Lord. Amen. Let's pray as we stand this morning. Father, we thank You, Lord, for today. Father, we are so thankful for Your word and the message. God, we thank You for Stephen. And God, the life that he lived. And Father, how his life impacted others for Your God, for Your kingdom. But not only did his life impact, but his death impacted others as well. And Father, I pray that, Lord, as we pray that, God, You would help us, Lord, just to be that witness, to be that light. Lord, to be that testimony, Father, to a lost and dying world. That, Father, people would truly see You that lives in us and not ourselves. God, we know that, Lord, You want and we know that You're able to take this church and use it mightily in this community for You. God, I pray that, Lord, we could see several souls saved and lives changed. And that people could come to know You, Father, not for us, not about us, Lord, but it's all about You. That, Lord, they could know the freedom. That they could know the forgiveness. They could know the newness of life that, Lord, only You can give. Lord, we're so thankful for the greatest gift that You ever give us, and that being Your Son, Jesus. We thank You for Calvary, and, Lord, we thank You for Your blood that You shed on the cross. And all this we ask in Your name. Amen. As we sing Mind the Lord this morning.
275.
appreciate that song this morning. Does anybody today have a testimony or have a word? Thank the Lord. Appreciate that, Brother Steve. Amen. Anybody else? Mind the Lord today. He's worthy of all praise, isn't he? And all honor we could give him. Amen. Amen. Appreciate that. Anybody else? God's been good to us, hasn't he? Blessed us with health, blessed us with strength, blessed us with everything we've got. And I'm so thankful for it. And all things come from him. And I'm glad to know that this morning. I'm thankful for the Lord and all his goodness today. His mercy endures forever. His grace is sufficient. Amen. And I'm thankful for that. Well, it certainly has been good to be in God's house. If you would, at this time, have just a seat. At this time, we're going to recognize, we're going to honor our graduates this year, and we are so thankful for our graduates, and I just encourage everybody to be praying for them as they're getting ready to start in a new chapter of their life. Some are going to be that's graduated high school. They're going to be going on to college or work or wherever they're going to be going, and then those that have graduated college, they're going to be joining the workforce and following on with their career, with their degree. So you just be much in prayer for them. Pray that God would lead them. Pray that God would direct them and guide them. Pray God open doors and opportunities for them and just make a way for them as they continue to go on the journey that God has set before them. I believe with all my heart, and the Bible teaches us and tells us, I believe God has a plan for each one of us, doesn't he? Amen? I believe that. I believe God has a plan and a purpose for each one of us. And I believe we've got to be praying, we need to be praying, that God reveals that plan to us, that shows us, that I like what Proverbs teaches us and tells us, says this. He said, that if we lean not unto our own understanding, but in all of our ways acknowledge him, he will direct our paths. Amen? God will show us in the way we need to go. So I'm thankful for that. You be much in prayer for them. I'm going to ask Miss Debbie Cox if she would come. And this time we're going to recognize and honor our graduates.
Every year at this time, our church recognizes our graduates. And the graduates from our high school, years ago, we decided that we would try to get maybe a smaller, more compact Bible for them to take with them, whether they go into workforce or whether they go on to college. Usually, our college graduates, we get the girls maybe a nice journal, the boys a billfold, pen and pencil set. It really just depends on what's available at that particular time. But today we want to honor the graduates, and our first one is going to be Ethan Taylor. And as he makes his way down, Ethan graduated May 15th from Union County High School with a 3.4 GPA. He received the CTE Cord for completing 4 years of banking and finance. Ethan was voted most dependable along with Ashlyn Walker for senior superlatives. Now Ethan says he's headed to the workforce. His parents are Matt and Sabrina Taylor. Congratulations, Ethan. And next is Ashlyn Walker. Ashlyn finished her Union County High School classes in December and was one of the class valedictorians with a 4.0 average. She also received two extra tassels, one for the blood drive and one for her work ethics. Ashlyn has already completed her first semester at Walter State Community College and is majoring in biology. Parents are Clint and Amanda Walker. Grandparents are Paul and Mary Jo Walker. Congratulations. And last but not least is our college graduate, Whitney Welch. Whitney has graduated from the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, and received a bachelor's degree in marketing with a sales concentration. Whitney is the daughter of Jeff and Ginger Welch. Congratulations, Whitney. Graduation brings on many changes into your life, along with new beginnings. It's a big world out there, and it's not always easy. Take your Bibles with you. Read it. It has all the answers to all your questions, and it will provide guidance and direction, whether it's off to college or into the workforce. 1 Timothy 4:12. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Congratulations, graduates.
Thank you, Debbie. If everybody would at this time, let's stand this morning. I'm going to ask our deacons if they would to come and receive the morning offering. And we pray you just give according to how God has laid on your heart. If you're visiting with us today, we do encourage you, if you would, take just a few minutes and fill out the guest card and drop it in the offering plate on your way out this morning. We are so thankful for our graduates. It's been a good day to be in God's house, hasn't it? And I'll never forget, I was reminded there as Debbie was reading that, when I graduated high school, my church was giving me a little New Testament and also received a little book. It's called Bible Promises. And I tell you what, I used that thing more right after I graduated high school, trying to find the direction that God would have for me in my life. And I tell you what, the best place is God's Word. Amen. And read it, study it, pray on it. God will lead you, He'll guide you, He'll direct you. And all the answers truly is in God's Word, and I'm so thankful for that. Amen. It's been good to be in God's house. We want you to come back, be with us on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. Be much in prayer for our service. Remember, our children will have their classes and youth downstairs, and then we'll have Bible study and prayer meeting up here. All right. If no one else has anything, we'll be dismissed this morning. I'm going to ask if... Brother John Walker would dismiss us.